Welcome to the Virtual Center for the Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility, an ongoing inquiry into American political origins and evolving institutions. The Executive Director of the Virtual Center is Dr. Bill Obrien. He's also your host for this continuing conversation. Here he is now, Dr. Bill Obrien.
Thank you, Bob Kincaid, and welcome to this Tuesday edition of the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. Today is the 30th day of July in the year 2019. We have one more day in this month, this 31-day month. And then on Thursday, we will enter the month of August. And I'm guessing, because it's fairly normal to expect, that August is the beginning of the period where you begin to go down the slope toward the fall. Now, the impact that climate change may have on all of this, on the way we kind of flow from one season into the other, is a little bit hard to predict. But, you know, we have summer weather in August, you know, really hot weather in August, traditionally. But at the same time, with the schools reopening and colleges and universities opening early or mid-August, it's usually in the mind, psychologically, in the minds of most folks, the end of the summer and the beginning of the slope into fall. But we'll have to see how all that works out. It is a pleasure to have you on this Tuesday, this 30th day of July, here at the Virtual Center. I'll be honest with you, I'm so excited about today's program. And part of the reason is because I got a little bit excited about yesterday's program. And I got so excited about it, I'm gonna begin where we left off. And on the issue that we left off at yesterday, I don't know, that's not really a good English, is it? Left off at, that doesn't sound very good. But on the other hand, if you ever get in a situation where you get embarrassed about your use of the English language, just remember that we've got the big chief up in Washington, D.C., and what he does to the language means that there's a lot more flexibility in how you use it than any of us ever believed there was. Anyway, again, welcome to the program. We would, as I mentioned every day at this time, we would love to have you interact with us. We have an 800 number, and if you call it, Bob and Agnes are both in the studios of Head On today, and one of them will answer the phone, and if you call, they'll get you on the air immediately. And all I want you to know is how welcome you are, and you can make, you know, you can offer your suggestions or raise questions whatever you are inclined to say in relationship to our program. The mere fact that you listen to this program, the mere fact that you listen to this network, is an indication that when you speak, it's worth everybody listening to. It's something everybody ought to hear. And that's one reason we wanted the 800 number. So if you'd like to come on the phone and on the air and share your thoughts with us, I want you to know how welcome that would be for us, for me personally, and for other listeners as well. The 800 number is 844-THE-HORN. That's 844-843-4676. But it's much easier if you remember 844-THE-HORN. If you'd like to make a comment to me about the program, and for one reason or another you're unable or a little bit uncomfortable about coming on the air, and believe me, I can understand that. But some of you may be working, for example, and you can't get on the air and carve out a portion of your workday to go off on an issue while you're at work, then feel free to sit down and send an email or to Facebook us using our Facebook page. If you'd like to send me an email, my email address is waobrien906@gmail.com. That's lowercase, all one word, no punctuation. waobrien, O-B-R-I-E-N, 906, @gmail.com. I mentioned some months ago, maybe it was longer than that, probably about a year ago, why I emphasize almost every day that my name is Obrien, I-E-N, because a number of people spell Obrien, I-A-N. When I was growing up, my dad used to make the point that the difference between I-E-N and I-A-N is the difference between Northern Ireland and in the Irish Republic. And that's becoming big news now with Brexit. Because if Great Britain withdraws from the European Union, and now the new Prime Minister, Boris Johnson, is saying that come hell or high water, they're going to be out of the European Union by April 30th. That means, at least for now, that if Britain leaves the EU, so also does Northern Ireland. Unless Northern Ireland insists on breaking from Great Britain. And that's going to create a problem between Northern Ireland and the Irish Republic. But, you know, that's a totally different issue. But my point was that that's the difference between Obrien with an A and Obrien with an E. A is Northern Ireland. E is the Irish Republic. So, you know, that's the reason I've just gotten in the habit of spelling it that way, because I've seen a lot of people, I get emails and everything else, where people inadvertently spell it with an A. It's very unlikely. Sometimes I get them, but more often than not, if you spell it with an A, I won't get it. The other way that you can comment, send me a comment, is by using our Facebook page. Just go to Facebook, facebook.com, and on the homepage of Facebook, you'll see a search box at the top. And if you type in the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution, you'll be onto our Facebook page and you'll see a number of postings there. If you go to any one of the postings, there are two computer links at the end of each posting, a share link and a comment link. If you click on the share link, it sends that particular posting to all the friends on your Facebook account, all your friends on Facebook. So that gives us much wider exposure, and obviously we would thank you if you choose to do that. If you click on the comment link, it gives you an opportunity to make a comment directly to me. And I will immediately get notification from Facebook that a comment to one of the postings on our Facebook page has been sent, and then Facebook will take me directly to the posting and your comment. So it won't take any time at all for me to receive your comment. And, you know, obviously the presumption, Facebook's presumption is that your comment would be related to the posting. And while that's the normal, it's not required. You can just use that as an opportunity to fire off a comment to me. And given the fact that so many of us are on Facebook so often, so much, it may be a lot easier and efficient for you to just, while you're on Facebook, to make the comment rather than click out of Facebook and click into your email and send an email. It might be just quicker and easier to do it through the Facebook page. But however you do it, what I want you to know is we appreciate it. We appreciate the time it would take you to write a comment or a suggestion or question or whatever, or reaction to a particular issue. The point is, I would love to hear from you. and our other listeners would as well. And the more interaction there is between audience and this program and the network, the more relevant our programs are, because they're much more inclined to be in tune with what the listeners want and believe and think and expect. So the more interaction there is, the better. That's the way we all learn. And I just want you to know that if we hear from you, when we hear from you, we're going to be excited. We are excited about it. And I want you to know that every time I get an email or a Facebook comment from a listener, I get excited. And more than just a couple of times, I've shared those with my wife, because they are usually very, very solid, substantive comments. And my wife made a comment, made a point after looking at one of these comments sent to me on the Facebook page maybe a week, 2 weeks ago, made the comment and said, "Boy, one thing about a comment like this, you know that there are people out there listening, don't you?" And I said, "Exactly." And that's encouraging. And I have never seen a comment or an email from one of our listeners that wasn't substantive and wasn't worth reading. So again, thank you very much. We appreciate you being there. We all know that Bob and Agnes and the folks at Head On depend on listeners exclusively to keep the network on the air. And it's been happening for a number of years. And we have our listeners to thank for that. And it's important for us to share with you the fact that we know that and we appreciate it. And we never for 1 minute take our audience for granted. So thank you. And let's kind of launch into today's program. I'd like to begin on the same issue that we ended with yesterday. Well, actually, I'd like to begin by just making a comment about a reminder more than anything else, that tonight is the first night of the second round of Democratic debates. And if you remember, the debates first round that was held in June, the luck of the draw resulted in Elizabeth Warren being the big name on the first night, with most of the nine other people on stage with her as being those candidates who at this point are far back in the running. And so the fact of the matter is the conclusions that most people drew after the first night was that Elizabeth Warren was by far the strongest candidate on stage that night. And if you look at it from a perspective of winning and losing, she clearly was the big winner that night. And most of the others, the heavy hitters, by the luck of the draw, were on the second night. And so it kind of made the second night of the first round of debates in June the night that most folks were waiting for, because that's when all the heavyweights were on stage together. Well, this time, the draw turned out to be a little bit different. And what I mean is that both evenings promised to be interesting. Tonight, for example, Elizabeth Warren is once again on the first night, but so also is Bernie Sanders and Pete Buttigieg, the mayor of South Bend, Indiana. And I'm kind of mentioning this because I have seen him interviewed, and he's worth listening to. And that's Steve Bullock, governor of Montana. He didn't make the cut in the first debate, but he made it this time, and he's going to be on stage this evening. As yet, he hasn't qualified for the next round of debates, which happen in September. In fact, 5 of the 10 people that are on stage tonight have not yet made the cutoff for the September debate. But be that as it may, Bullock is on stage tonight. And I've heard him interviewed a couple of times, and I find him impressive. And I'm sure he'll make this point tonight in some way. He's a Democratic governor in a red state. He won in a Trump state. And he's got administrative experience. And he has a pretty ambitious and broad agenda. He's extremely articulate. And I don't know exactly what kind of a performance to expect in the debate. I don't know if he's ever been in a debate before. I know that he wasn't in the one in June. But he's going to be on stage tonight, and so that means that this is going to be the first time that the vast majority of the viewing public has had an opportunity to see him and listen to him. Now, what that is going to mean, I don't know. He could be a bust. But on the other hand, I don't know. When I heard him interviewed, I thought he was pretty good and worth listening to. Also, Amy Klobuchar is going to be on stage tonight, as well as Tim Ryan of Ohio. And, you know, a number of other people that are worth listening to. A former governor of Colorado, Hickenlooper, is going to be on tonight. And he also is listening, is interesting to listen to. So I'm kind of looking forward to tonight. I'm also, most of the pundits are anticipating some sort of fireworks between Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren. And apparently the way that the 10 people are going to be lined up on stage, Elizabeth Warren is going to have Bernie Sanders on one side and Mayor Pete on the other. And some people are expecting that this is the first time that Bernie and Elizabeth Warren, who pretty much are running on the same progressive end of the political spectrum, this will be the first shot that each has at the other. And some people are concluding that ultimately one or the other of those two is going to have to knock the other one out eventually. And so the anticipation seems to be that tonight may be the night, may be the opportunity for Bernie to take some serious shots at Elizabeth Warren, or vice versa. And a lot of people are saying there's going to be a good opportunity, if something like that happens, to speculate as to whether, in fact, one or the other of them seems to be able to withstand an attack and therefore shows signs of being able to stand toe-to-toe at some point in time with Donald Trump. So that's, you know, that's a factor. However, my guess is, and this is just me speculating, I don't have any basis for this at all, but I try to put myself in Bernie's shoes, and I try to put myself in Elizabeth Warren's shoes. And my conclusion is that indeed, at some point in time, they're going to have to take each other on. But this early in the debate, with this many other candidates, they both may feel that the most important thing right now is establishing your credibility and your debating strategy, if you will, in order to provide some element of confidence among the viewing public that you're capable of being a viable candidate if it comes down to the very end and you end up being pitted against Donald Trump. Yes, eventually, Bernie and Elizabeth Warren are going to have to go at each other. But they both may have concluded, and this is what I'm guessing, that they don't have to do it tonight. It may be that tonight is going to be devoted to a lot of the things that are happening right now, like the president's attack on Elijah Cummings and the city of Baltimore and the southern border and the incoming nominee for the National Security Advisor, who's John Ratcliffe, who many of you remember was one of the Republicans on the, I think, on the judicial committee, on the Judiciary Committee, that was involved in questioning Robert Mueller last Wednesday. And you may remember that Rutledge kind of, kind of stood out because his attack on Mueller and the report, the Mueller report, was blistering. And it was right after that performance that Donald Trump announced that he would be the nominee to replace the current occupant who's stepping down on the 15th of the month, and I'm absolutely drawing a blank on the name. But he's current national security advisor, and he's extremely competent, former senator, and he's done a darn good job. At least when you look at Rutledge's credentials, because they aren't there. And there's some anticipation that this nomination before the Senate is not going to be that easy for Rutledge because he doesn't have the credentials. He doesn't have the experience. Many people believe that he's too political. He's too partisan to be involved in defending and leading the agency that's assigned the protection of the security of the nation. But there's a little bit more to that story. And that is, and this is what appears to be, it appears that Rutledge's performance in the Mueller hearing was an interview for the job. Because it turns out that President Trump had talked to Rutledge 2 weeks before the Mueller hearing about his qualifications to fill that particular position should it become open. And it's dawned on me now that the present person in that position is Dan Coats. I was stuck for a name. That happens more to me all the time of late, but I seem to have trouble remembering names, unlike what used to be. The only thing that I'm banking on is that I spend most of my time in the 18th century. So far, I haven't had any trouble remembering those names. When I do, I'm in trouble. But anyway, the person that I was trying to think of is Dan Coats. And he announced that he's stepping down on the 15th of August. But if you recall, about 2 weeks ago, the president announced that he would be leaving. So it's not quite clear yet as to whether Coats is leaving because he wanted to or because Trump told him if he didn't leave voluntarily, he'd be canned. But more than 2 weeks ago, 2 weeks before the Mueller hearings, Trump talked to Rutledge about filling that position. And soon after that, Rutledge made an appearance on Fox News and launched into a glowing defense of President Trump and his presidency. And some people conclude that his appearance and presentation on Fox News, on Fox, was, in a sense, his effort to get the job that the president had already talked to him about. And then came the Mueller hearings. And other than Nunes, whose minority member leader on the committee, the next speaker was Rutledge. And if you remember, he really blistered Robert Mueller. And it was at that point the president announced he had the job. What I'm suggesting is that it appears that this guy is a politician all the time, and that his appearance in the interrogation of Robert Mueller and his report really had clear political overtones, and the whole thing was a performance. And if that's true, and it appears to be, then that in itself is evidence that this guy is too political to fill that role as a leader in America's national security force. And when you combine it with the fact that he really doesn't have the kind of credentials that position would seem to warrant, you begin to wonder whether this is yet another appointment the president has made where loyalty and commitment to him personally is all that matters, and whether you get the job or not, not whether you know anything about it or even understand what it is. And if you think about the president's cabinet thus far, you begin to see that there are a lot of people on it that are in positions of responsibility in areas they knew little about. What they have in common is they're supporters of Donald Trump. And they are loyal to him, and they're willing to say it, and they're willing to say it publicly. And that seems to be what the president wants. And in Rutledge's case, he said it on Fox. He made it very clear that he'll take his marching orders from the president. So in effect, he'll become yet another head of an agency whose continuation in office depends on his fealty to the president, which leads further into the area of authoritarianism in the minds of many people. So I think this is important as well. Anyway, that's what I wanted to talk about, was the debate this evening and the president's pending appointment. Well, he's appointed. The question is, will he be nominated? And there were serious, serious questions about it. I'd like to really open the program by returning to the issue that we closed yesterday's program with, which is the relationship between Abraham Lincoln and Karl Marx. Because it's a relationship that most of us really didn't know about. But more important than that, it's a relationship that flies in the face of today's Republican Party and its leadership. Because today's Republicans, from President Trump to Mitch McConnell, President of the Senate, have claimed on numerous occasions of Lincoln in the 21st century. And part of that leadership is to attack Democrats, especially the most progressive wing of the Democratic Party, as socialist radicals, communists. The president called the four congresswomen of color 2 weeks ago. Communists. And so the party of Lincoln, under the leadership of Donald Trump and Mitch McConnell principally, is distancing the Republican Party from socialism as part of its 2020 election strategy. So to muddy the waters by talking about an extended relationship between Abraham Lincoln and Karl Marx, none other than Karl Marx, seems to raise an issue which is fascinating on its face, if you think about it. It basically raises serious questions about the election strategy that Republican leaders clearly intend to pursue, which is to try to paint these four women and the progressive voices within the Republican Party as the face of the entire Republican Party. And as Donald Trump said recently, attack all Democrats as socialist radicals and prospective revolutionaries. McConnell hasn't used the word communist, I don't think, but the president has. And so there's a blatant contradiction here that I think makes the issue fascinating. And so I think that in itself is significant. And you'll recall that yesterday we were talking about an article that appeared on Saturday, this past Saturday, July 27th, in the Washington Post, written by Jillian Brockhill, in which she addresses a book written by John Nichols entitled The S Word, A Short History of an American Tradition Social Work. Socialism. I don't know what made me say social work. Socialism. And that, the rest of the article is pretty much a review of the book written by John Nichols, which addresses the relationship between Lincoln and Marx, between the Republican Party in Marx, but more important, the relationship between Karl Marx and the basic ideals and ideas which built the Republican Party in the 1850s into the party that elected Abraham Lincoln in 1860. Jillian Brockhill's article itself in last Saturday's Post opens with President Lincoln's State of the Union message, his first one to Congress, to the House and Senate. And in that address, after he talked about Southern secession and the war that was currently underway by December of 1861, because you remember that Southern states began to secede with Lincoln's election in November of 1860. So this first annual State of the Union message to Congress is a year, close to a year, after Lincoln became president. And he talks about the disloyalty of Southerners, about the rebellion against the Union, about the strength of the Union Army and Navy, and since it's Congress, obviously, Lincoln went into issues related to the budget. You can get this speech online. I got it and I read it. It's extremely lengthy. There's a lot in it. But the issue that Lincoln ends with is an issue that the Chicago Tribune subtitled "The Issue of Capital Versus Labor." And this is the quote from Lincoln's State of the Union message, which is straight Karl Marx. "Labor is prior to and independent of capital. Capital is only the fruit of labor and could never have existed if labor had not first existed. Labor is the superior of capital and deserves much the higher consideration," unquote. President Trump has said in one of his rallies that a vote for any Democrat in the next election is a vote for the rise of radical socialism, and that Representative Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez and other congresswomen of color are, quote, a bunch of communists. Yet the fact remains, and that's what the thrust of this article and John Nichols's book is about, the thrust of this is that the first Republican president, whom President Trump has continually expressed admiration for, was surrounded by socialists and looked to socialists to counsel the new Republican Party. This was a State of the Union message to Congress, a Congress that was filled with a lot of Republicans. And he was espousing the ideas of Karl Marx. And the fact of the matter is, Congress didn't get up and walk out. They didn't boo him. They accepted what he was saying about capital and labor because they knew it. They had read about it. They were prepared for it, and they believed in it. So what we are talking about here, and what makes this issue so important, it seems to me, is to recognize that the Republican Party was born and built on the ideas of socialism. And the members of the Republican Party during this period read, discussed, and adopted many of the socialist ideas that were written in the New York Tribune, which became the newspaper of the Republican Party, the newspaper that had hired Karl Marx as its British correspondent. And from his appointment in 1852, for the next 10 years, Karl Marx wrote 500 editorials, which appeared on the front page of the New York Tribune, and members of the Republican Party read them all, and the President of the United States read them all. This is unbelievable, because basically when you think about it, it makes one realize that the Democrats, even those who call themselves democratic socialists like Bernie Sanders, are in effect more in tune with the credentials and the ideals of the Republican Party than the Republican candidate for president is, than the Republican president of the Senate is, than the majority that controls the United States Senate, Republicans all, are. In effect, they are the revolutionaries. They are the outliers. Because ultimately, what gave birth to the Republican Party was a legitimate back and forth dialogue, discussion, and debate, if you will, between those committed to the ideas of capitalism and those socialists which raise serious questions about the viability and the humanity of capitalism. It suddenly makes one realize that progressives, born the Progressive Party, so-called, born in the early 20th century, ultimately was born in opposition to a Republican Party that had veered away from the ideals of Lincoln. The Republican Party, by the early 20th century, all through the Gilded Age, had basically veered away from the ideals on which the Republican Party was founded. And the Progressive Party, which emerged, which was born out of this concern, ultimately became the party of Theodore Roosevelt and Woodrow Wilson both. And so what we had in the election of 1912 was a presidential election between three candidates, two progressives and one traditional so-called Republican, Taft, William Howard Taft. But it turns out that Taft wasn't a Republican at all. The Roosevelt progressives, the so-called Bull Mooses, were the real Republicans. Taft and the small group of Republicans he led, which was the big money group that had overseen the so-called Gilded Age and the emergence of corporate America, they were the ones who violated the goals and ideals of the Republican Party because they bought into unfettered free enterprise, hook, line, and sinker. They became anti-socialist because they became committed capitalists. And for those people that maintain loyalty to the traditions of the Republican Party, they became progressives. And it turned out then that in the election of 1912, Taft came in a distant third in the election. The real contest was between Theodore Roosevelt and Woodrow Wilson, the Democrat and the progressive candidate. Wing of the Republican Party, headed by Taft, came back into power in the 20s under Harding, Coolidge, and ultimately Hoover, for the most part, because of World War One, and because of opposition to Woodrow Wilson and the idea of the League of Nations. And so the 1920s was a period in which the country was being run by traditional capitalist corporate people under the name Republican. But the problem was that progressivism had pretty much took a beating in the public mind because of Wilson's leadership in World War One and because of his effort to get the United States into the League of Nations. And so when the market collapsed in 1929, and Hoover didn't seem to have everything it took to pull the nation out of the enveloping depression, the American people turned to a new voice, that of FDR, Franklin Delano Roosevelt. And Roosevelt led the nation into a return to progressivism. So basically, my whole point here is that what we are talking about is a tradition that was born in the 1850s under the heading of Republican Party, that was significantly influenced by socialism and by Karl Marx. And many of the Republicans who sat in Congress in 1861 when Lincoln delivered this address were socialists. They were influenced heavily by the New York Tribune and by the ideas of editorials written by Karl Marx. I think this is an incredible story. And it makes me realize that these guys who are running against communists and democratic socialists in 2020 are really the outliers. They're the ones. And they are the ones that are the revolutionaries in a sense, because they continue to advocate that the United States continue in the direction of abandoning the ideals which formed the foundation of their own party. I think it's fascinating. I think it's incredible, and I think it's exciting. But there's one more facet of this that I'd like to introduce before we drop the subject entirely. And we've got about 12 minutes left in this first hour. And I'd like to try to do this in that 12 minutes, if I can. But I really think that this is very important. And it goes back to the issue of Karl Marx himself and to the ideas of socialism. Why is it that so few of us know anything about this? Why is it that so few of us know anything about Karl Marx, let alone Abraham Lincoln? And I believe I mentioned yesterday, and I want to mention it again because I think it's important, that I think what makes this whole issue significant is for what it tells us about the way we educate our young people. And I go back, and I know I mentioned this yesterday. A few years ago, I delivered a paper, and it was in celebration of Constitution Day, the 17th of September. And it was a paper on the Constitution, and West Virginia's own Senator Byrd, Robert C. Byrd, who passed away since then, was instrumental in getting Congress the legislation through that established September 17th as Constitution Day in this country. And the legislation also required that every institution which receives federal grant money has to acknowledge and plan something special every 17th of September in honor of the Constitution. Because September 17th is the day that the Constitutional Convention adjourned. The lecture I gave, the paper I delivered, was entitled, "The History We Read is the History We Look For." And what my thesis was, and is, because I haven't changed my mind at all, if anything, I'm more convinced than I ever was that this is significant. What it suggests is that our education system, since its inception, has principally been committed to ideological mind control, if you will, in that it seeks to sell the history of this nation, which is most acceptable to those in power. The people with the power and the money and the influence to dictate what goes into our textbooks and what goes into our public K through 12 curriculum are the ones who determine what the content is in our history textbooks and what content will never be there. And we know from the Cold War and the threat of international communism and the fear created in this country of the revolutionary and radical ideas of Marxist socialist communism basically rendered the ideas of Karl Marx persona non grata in this country, to the point that Marx is rarely even mentioned in our textbooks, let alone dealt with. Not only that, but Marx's name itself has become pretty much persona non grata. And the paper that I delivered in that September 17th address a few years ago, because it was Constitution Day, focused principally on Thomas Jefferson and James Madison. And my thesis was that in each case, there was or had been a definitive history of that particular person published, a definitive biography or biographical account, if you will. In the case of Thomas Jefferson, it was Carl Becker's book written in the early 1920s, entitled The Declaration of Independence, which became the definitive interpretation of Thomas Jefferson's work in 1876. And Becker's thesis was that Jefferson took the Declaration of Independence directly from John Locke, and that Locke's championing of private property and liberty and individual freedom, which conformed exactly to the priorities of unfettered, unregulated free market capitalism, went down as the definitive story of Jefferson's declaration. which led to conclusions or interpretations that even though Jefferson didn't mention the word property in the Declaration, and surely didn't assert that property, the ownership of property, was an unalienable right, his interpreters did. And they sold the idea that even though Jefferson said life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, the only reason he did that is because he was afraid to use the word property in the Declaration, because it would make the American War for Independence, for which the Declaration was drafted, appear to be a war to defend the property owners and not the individual freedom of all citizens. The pursuit of happiness phrase seemed to be something that these people believed they could sell, and they did. And Becker's interpretation of the Declaration of Independence ended up becoming the definitive, universally included story of Jefferson's Declaration of Independence. So the fact of the matter is, the history we read, which is what Jefferson was all about, is the history that those who write it want us to believe. And then there's Madison. Madison also, in Federalist Number 10, supports the priorities of free enterprise capitalism by coming down hard on the side of individual liberty and freedom, and ultimately on the idea of self-interest, by suggesting in Federalist Number 10 that factions, self-interest, is sown into the nature of man. Man is born greedy. Man is born selfish. Man is born competitive. Man is born wanting to achieve success, which is exactly what free enterprise capitalism is all about. Charles Beard included Madison's Federalist Number 10 as the opening portion of his 1913 book, An Economic Interpretation of the Constitution, and basically suggested that Madison and the founders really wrote the Constitution primarily to benefit property owners and capitalists and financiers and investors and commercial interests, not the people. That was secondary. In other words, the people that wrote the Constitution and voted for it did it for their own self-interest. And that became kind of the definitive view of the Constitution for the balance of the 20th century and into this, the 21st. In other words, Beard's economic interpretation of the Constitution has been challenged, but never successfully refuted. The fact of the matter is, in both Madison's case and Jefferson's case, the history we grew up with, the history we've read, is the history that those with the influence and power to bring it about want us to read. And that means that the side of Jefferson that talks about social consciousness, that talks about the moral sense in every human being, that talks about man's innate sense of commitment to his neighbor, and the fact that man was born to be a social animal and was born to live in communities with other human beings, and therefore needed to act appropriately, and therefore unfettered freedom was not something that one could justify within community. All of that in Jefferson is ignored. Nobody knows about it. But also the same things exist in Madison. Because in Federalist number 49, Madison said, granted, there is greed and self-interest as part of human nature. We know that. But many people have chosen to make that the whole story of what human nature is about. And Madison said, if they are right, if that was true, then self-government wouldn't even be possible. This republic wouldn't have a chance. The Constitution, he said, was drafted based on the faith that exists, that there are good qualities in human nature, which make it possible for people to live together and flourish together. If human nature was as these other people want it to be, then the only government that could possibly work would be despotism, because only a government with absolute power could force obedience of its own people if those people were as self-interested and greedy as these folks would have us believe. That part of Madison is never talked about. Nobody knows about that stuff. And now Karl Marx. And when you begin to see Karl Marx totally excluded from the history of this country, and when you realize that the ideas of Karl Marx formed the very foundation of the modern Republican Party, and you now realize that we're moving into an election where the President of the United States, who claims that he's a member of that party, and the President of the Senate, who claims he is heading up the party of Lincoln, and the senatorial majority that Mitch McConnell controls are intent on running a political campaign aimed at ultimately destroying enemies to the people, which are these democratic, socialist, revolutionary, radical communists. And one has to conclude that the history we read is the history we've been taught to read and believe. We've gone a couple of minutes out over the first hour, and I do apologize for that. I had 8 minutes, 9 minutes, and I spent about 12, and I apologize. But we're going to break right now. We're going to take a five-minute break, and then we'll come back for our second hour here on the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. I hope you'll stay with us. It'll be a short break. Thank you. Thank you.
Bill?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay. All right, we're back.
Okay. I'm ready.
Okay, there you go. You're on.
I'm on. Okay. Well, thank you, Agnes. Welcome to our second hour on this Tuesday edition of the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution and Civic Responsibility. Today is Tuesday. It is the 30th day of July in the year 2019. For those of you just joining us, welcome. For those of you who were here through the first hour and are still with us, thank you. I appreciate that. For the people just joining us, let me mention that in the first hour, we spent the entire time featuring the relationship between Karl Marx and Abraham Lincoln and the political ramifications of that and what's happening to it and who the revolutionaries are and who the revolutionaries are not. And so we're going to change issues a little bit in this our second hour, but I want to make sure before we do that that I invite your reaction to the first hour. If you would like to react to some of what we talked about on this particular issue of Lincoln, then by all means, I know that our listeners and I know that I personally would love to hear from you. In order to make that happen, we have an 800 number that will take you directly into the Head On Radio Network studios. Agnes is there, and she'll connect you, and you'll be on the air with us momentarily. The 800 number is 844-THE-HORN, 844-THE-HORN. Or if you'd like to communicate with me in a comment, you can do so in one of two ways. You can send me an email, or you can comment to me on through our Facebook page. If you'd like to send me an email, my email address is waobrien906@gmail.com. If you'd prefer to communicate with me directly through our Facebook page, then go to our Facebook page, facebook.com, and in the search box at the top, type in the Virtual Center for Study of the Constitution. You'll be onto our Facebook page, and you'll see a number of postings. And after each posting, there are two computer links, a share link and a comment link. If you click on the share and the comment link, that will give you the opportunity to direct a comment directly to me. I'll be notified by my Facebook account that such a comment has been made on one of the postings on our Facebook page, and then Facebook will immediately bring up on my computer the particular posting and your comment on it. But, and let me emphasize this, your comment doesn't necessarily have to be related to the posting. By reading it, I'm going to know immediately whether you're reacting to the posting or whether you're reacting to something else that we've talked about here on the Virtual Center. The point of all of it is that we want to encourage interaction and communication wherever and whenever possible. So again, in anticipation of this happening, all I want you to know is that we appreciate it and we thank you. And now I'd like to get into a completely different issue on today's program. It's an issue that is very current. It's an issue that we spent some time on yesterday, early in the program. It deals with the president's attack on Elijah Cummings, chairman of the Oversight Committee in the House of Representatives, Democrat from the state of Maryland, an elected representative from the district that includes Baltimore. And I'm not going to go through all the details of what the president said, but we know that 2 weeks ago he launched into an attack on the four freshman congresswomen of color, referring to them en masse as the squad. has called them radical socialist revolutionaries and all the rest of it, and for it, and telling them to go back where they came from when three of the four were born here, suggested to many people that the president's comments were racist. I personally believe, even though that's been challenged by the president and by other Republicans, I believe that it is. I also want to share a little story that Bob shared with me before we came on the air, that Bob has some polling data that indicates that 67% of Republican Trump supporters believe that there's nothing wrong with using the N-word, that it's not racist. And so one has to wonder what definition of racism these people are actually going by. Because the N-word has been the flagship identifier of racism in this country for years. And many of us are aware of the president's comments about Mexicans and asylum seekers coming across the southern border and some of the vile things that the president and his supporters have said about Mexicans, about Latin America, about brown people, about poor people. That was a couple of weeks ago. This weekend, the target of the president's attacks was another African-American leader within the Republican Party, chairman of the Oversight Committee, Elijah Cummings. And this attack began on Saturday and extended through the weekend with follow-up tweet after follow-up tweet. And I believe I heard mentioned this morning of the fact that the president has sent this already about 30 tweets on this particular issue, in which the attacks have become more vile and the assertions that this is not racist at all have become more and more frequent, to the point that in one of the most recent tweets, the president has concluded that he's not the racist, Elijah Cummings is. And then Monday morning, the attack on Elijah Cummings was accompanied by an attack on Al Sharpton. I think everybody knows this. And as part of the attack on Elijah Cummings this weekend, the president attacked the slum conditions and circumstances in inner city Baltimore. And the president attacked Elijah Cummings for it because it's his district. And the president implied that Elijah Cummings would do better focusing his attention on the needs of the people in his district instead of attacking those coming across the border and living in the camps that are overseen by the Border Patrol in the South. And more important, the attacks on the Department of Homeland Security for the horrendous conditions under which these people, and especially the children, are forced to live. And last Friday, many of us witnessed the video of the Oversight Committee hearings in which Chairman Elijah Cummings was speaking to the witness who currently heads the Department of Homeland Security. I think his name is Al Neenan, something like that, and was screaming at him about the horrendous conditions that these children are being forced to live in. And Cummings made reference to the fact that these people are denied shower facilities. They're forced to sit and live in their own feces. And he screamed at the chairman of Homeland Security and said, come on, man, these are human beings. President Trump's attack on Elijah Cummings was an effort to deflect attention from the border by making the point that Elijah Cummings would be better served by spending more time correcting the horrendous conditions in Baltimore and less on the conditions on the southern border, and criticism of the noble efforts of the Department of Homeland Security and the heroes in border control, who are doing the very best they can to handle an invasion of this country. And I won't get into the details of the attack on Baltimore, but among the president's comments are that in Baltimore, inner city Baltimore, is a rat and rodent infested mess, and that Baltimore is a place that no human being would voluntarily live in. And of course, once again, the issue of racism came up. Many people began to defend Baltimore. One of them was Al Sharpton, who immediately went to Baltimore with Michael Steele, who's former chairman of the Republican National Committee and appears frequently on MSNBC. And they basically went to Baltimore and defended its people against the attack coming from the President of the United States. The principal difference is between this and the attack on the four congresswomen. One of the principal differences in the two circumstances or situations is that many Republicans, at least privately, although none of them, very few of them, were willing to stand up and assert this publicly, were very uncomfortable about the president's comments directed at the four congresswomen. They wouldn't say so, and they wouldn't come out publicly and challenge the president or his comments. But reports were that privately, many of them were concerned. They felt that the president went overboard. They felt that his comments were inappropriate. Some prominent Republicans were willing to go that far and no further. And the ones who were willing to take a position and question the legitimacy and the appropriateness of the president's comments usually followed it by joining in the president's attack against the four women and the attacks against radical democratic socialism, which means that even though they were somewhat critical of the president, they followed up the criticism, such as it was, with their own attack. I think I have to. But on the other hand, it's pretty obvious that I'm with you, Mr. President. That was the reality of the situation surrounding the attack on the president's attack on the four women. But the attack on Elijah Cummings is different. And what we see happening is that not only aren't Republicans criticizing the president for his comments about Elijah Cummings and about the horrendous circumstances in Baltimore, but in fact, many Republicans have joined in the attack, both against Cummings and especially against the inner city Baltimore conditions. And one of the things that's become very clear in the last 24 hours since yesterday's program here in the virtual center is that it's appearing more and more likely that Republican leaders plan to take this and run with it as we move forward towards the 2020 elections. Because increasingly, many Republicans are beginning to publicly point out that most of the Americans' major cities are in blue states. They are the places where the bulk of African Americans and immigrants live in this country, and almost exclusively they are controlled by Democrats. They are blue states. They are cities that are Democratic in their nature, in the way the people who live in them vote. And that it's been that way for a long time, and therefore that the Democrats are vulnerable for the conditions in America's inner cities. And as that becomes increasingly clear, it also becomes clear that Republicans intend to use this as a weapon in the 2020 election campaign against Democrats. And this is so real and so important that some of the pundits are beginning to suggest that the Democratic candidates who are debating tonight and tomorrow night are going to have to address this issue somehow. Nobody knows how. Nobody knows for sure if they will. But Republican leaders, senators, congressmen, etc., are putting pressure on the media by suggesting that everybody ought to watch and see whether the media, who will be asking the questions in these debates, have the guts to raise the issue of American city, urban America, to these candidates and put them on the spot. That, to me, is the biggest signal or sign that Republicans intend to make this a major thrust of the 2020 election campaign. And so as we go into the debate tonight, the issue kind of stands there. But let me suggest to you that there's more. And let me suggest what some of that more is. On July 28th, 2 days ago, an article appeared in the Washington Post reminding us that some months ago, significant research data was released, principally in the Washington Post, about the property investments of the family of Ivanka's husband, Jared Kushner. Kushner Properties is a major investor in real estate. And it so happens, and I think you know what's coming, that a significant number of units, apartment units, that are part of Kushner's management business are in Baltimore. And the author of this piece on the 28th, Rebecca Tan, reminds us that the president's criticism of Baltimore rang with a particular irony in Baltimore County, where presidential son-in-law Jared Kushner owns more than a dozen apartment complexes that have been cited for hundreds of code violations and critics say provides substandard housing to lower income tenants. So the fact of the matter is, the very conditions that the president is pinning on Elijah Cummings as representative of that district are conditions which are contributing to the wealth of Jared Kushner and the family business. Kushner Companies, which started operating in Maryland in 2013, has owned almost 9,000 rental units across 17 apartment complexes, many of them in Baltimore County. All of this was data published in the Baltimore Sun earlier this year. These Baltimore properties generate at least $90 million in annual revenue. Kushner stepped down as chief executive of the company in 2017 when he became senior White House advisor. In 2017, Baltimore County officials revealed that apartments owned by the Kushner firm were responsible for more than 200 code violations, all accrued in the calendar year 2017. Repairs were made only after the county threatened fines, local officials said. And even after warnings, violations on 9 properties were not addressed, resulting in monetary sanctions. A private investigator who looked into Kushner's property management company, Westminster Management, described the managers as slumlords. So the fact of the matter is, it is indeed ironic that President Trump would choose to attack the city where his own son-in-law's business is pulling better than $90 million a year out of that city, those slums that the president continues to attack. Basically, and this is a quote, Kushner has been creating a race to the bottom in terms of poorly maintained properties, an official in Baltimore County said. He's been very, very deeply implicated. It's been our recent experience that working families have been preyed on at the benefit of Mr. Kushner and his company. So there we have it. So it seems to me that if the Republicans push forward with their plans to make inner city conditions controlled by Democrats a campaign issue in 2020. I apologize for the phone. For the phone that's ringing. If you don't mind, I'm going to answer this. I apologize. It's my granddaughter, and I got to let her in the house. So I apologize. I'll be right with you. Agnes always says this is a family program and a place. Back issue at hand. Thank you for that time. But she just got off work and was going to come by after work, but we thought it would be after we went off the air, but it turns out it wasn't. So I kind of apologize for that. I think that this issue is pretty important. And the only point I was going to make about it, and the point I was making before the interruption, is that if the Republicans follow through on their plans, parent plans, to make inner city conditions, which are in Democratic districts, a major issue in the campaign, then that's going to indicate or demand that Republicans meet that Democrats meet that challenge. They have to respond in some way. And the fact of the matter is, the most logical response, as I see it, is the budget. Because since Donald Trump became president, Republicans have controlled the Senate, and up until the midterms this past November, Republicans controlled the House as well. Which means that Republicans controlled both branches of the federal government for the last 3.5 years, for the last 3 years. And during that time, the domestic budget, the federal money flowing into America's cities, housing subsidies, Medicare subsidies, health care subsidies, all of it has been cut. While the Republican Congress has pushed through a tax cut bill, which has increased the size of the deficit by $1.5 billion. Did I say billion? $1 trillion. And 83% of the recipients of that tax cut have been the wealthiest Americans, including corporations. And the criticisms have been piling up because even before he retired, Paul Ryan, as Speaker of the House when it was Republican controlled, along with Mitch McConnell, were responsible for looking to social programs to make up the budget gap created by the tax cut. So ultimately, this gets into the issue of federal government willingness to support the cities. And we know Donald Trump. And we know that Donald Trump has always believed from the beginning that he is not the president of all the people. He's the president of the people that voted for him. And they don't live in the cities. Therefore, their funding has been cut over and over and over and over. And Democrats, especially elected Democrats, have access to the kind of data that can blow this Republican strategy of a tax on the inner city out of the water, I believe. It could start this evening in the first day of the second round of debates. If the media takes up the challenge of Republicans by raising this question of inner city conditions and blaming it on Democrats, it would seem to be foolish for Democratic presidential candidates to not respond in kind. I've thought about this a lot this morning, and let me be honest about it. if I can see this, surely they can. The issue is going to be how hard they want to come down on those pushing the question on the president, on the Senate leadership, the Senate majority of Republicans. After all, this is a Democratic debate to win the nomination and go up against Donald Trump in the election. It is not the election itself, the campaign itself. So therefore, one can anticipate that there's going to be more emphasis on candidates distinguishing themselves from their competitors than it is one aimed at Republicans or the Republican president. But on the other hand, the Republicans' behavior seems to me in so many ways to be have become so outlandish that in spite of the situation, I'll be surprised if Democrats don't respond aggressively to the direction of the, you know, to these kinds of questions and the direction they are aimed at taking the debate in. If the questions are asked, the purpose is to create a problem for Democratic presidential candidates. And since the debate is on national television and it's going to be viewed by a lot of people, especially tonight because of the nature of who's on stage, to not respond would be suicidal on the part of the Democrats. They almost have to respond. If they do it in a proper way, it seems to me, in the right way, they can kill this issue before it has a chance to get off the ground. Because it seems to me the conditions in Baltimore, or tonight's debate is in Detroit. Detroit is majority African-American population. Detroit has been in trouble for a long time. As we know, the water conditions in Flint, Michigan, have been a national issue for some time. I saw an article just this weekend which indicated that people in Flint continue to not trust the quality of the water and continue to purchase bottled water for their families. So the point is that it would be easy for Republicans to lump Detroit and Baltimore together and try to make it an issue in this campaign, along with conditions even in inner city San Francisco, for example. I heard one Republican commenting on inner city San Francisco. And you have Chicago, and you have Boston, and you have Washington, D.C. itself. And so the point is that this is an issue that if it's raised by Republicans, if the media raises it in the questioning tonight, Democrats cannot afford a response to it. So I think, you know, I think this is really, really an interesting issue. But again, I think that there is a response. I think it's a viable response. I think it's meaningful. I think it makes sense. And when you include the president's son-in-law in the Baltimore attack, you begin to see the possibilities that Democrats can weaponize this whole issue and turn it right back in the president's face. And I kind of wait with bated breath, because I think that that is what might just happen if the issue is raised on stage at all tonight. in the Detroit debates. So those, it seems to me, are two issues. That I believe are significant, very significant. I continue to be amazed every time I think of the Karl Marx Abraham Lincoln connection. Not only the depth of it, but the results of it, and how those results have been swept under the America's rug for so long, to the point that Republicans now feel comfortable running against the very ideology that their own party was founded upon. I just think that's amazing. We did that the whole first hour, but it just flashed in my mind again, and I can't. Every time I think of it, I'm more amazed. So where are we now? I mentioned yesterday that we would devote a significant portion of today's program to the issue, to the Jill Lepore issue, and the whole idea of the nation's history and the importance of its history in order to build citizenship and help build a nation. Obviously, I want to get back to that. And I think my intent right now is to spend a significant portion of tomorrow's program on Wednesday on that particular issue. But let me, and to be honest with you, I think it's important that we do that tomorrow, because I have kind of an announcement that I meant to make at the very beginning of today's program and totally forgot to make. I shared it with Bob. But I'm going to have to bail out on live programming next week, and maybe for at least one program the week after, perhaps two. I'm not sure. I'm a little bit unsure. Beginning this week, on Thursday, my wife and I are going to be responsible for the care and feeding of three grandchildren for the next 10 days while their parents go on vacation. And while this is a challenge, it's more of a challenge than I even like to think about, the fact of the matter is, it's a challenge. My wife has told me several times in the last day or two, you're going to help me with these children. And what that means is you can't spend 2 or 3 hours a day preparing a program. And so I shared this with Bob, and I said, the best thing that I can do is just not even try to consider doing programs next week. And then, of course, at the end of that period, we have to take the children to New England once their parents come home and then come back. So it could be that I'm talking 2 weeks of live programs here. Because while I'm in New England, I have family there, and I haven't seen them for the better part of a year. And so, you know, I wanted to mention that because I think it's important. I'll try to mention it again at the beginning of tomorrow's program. But that reality seems to me to make it imperative that we devote as much as possible of tomorrow's 2 hours to this Jill Lepore issue, important as it is. And let me share with you why I think this is so important in light of the program that we've been doing for the last 45 minutes or so of this, our second hour. What we are talking about here is the issue of building a nation. What Jill Lepore is talking about is the role that the nation's history itself plays in successfully building this nation. And what that means is providing the kind of common ingredients that a pluralistic, diverse population can rally around and agree on. In other words, establish the foundations, the principles, which become the common ground around which this nation continues to exist and flourish. We are a nation that is divided into different nationalities, races, religions, colors, ethnicity. That makes us different than most nations in the world. And what that means is, we were a state when we declared our independence, and this is review from what we did last time we get into this issue. When we declared our independence from Great Britain, we became a free and independent confederation, series of states. But then the challenge was to build those states into a nation. How do you do it? What do you base the commonalities of all of those states on? And the answer to that question, I believe, and Jill Lepore believes, is the very essence of what republicanism means. Individual freedom, competition, massive public participation in governing, government regulation of the private sector, not abolition of individual liberty, but regulation of the economy in such a way that the economy doesn't divide the population, but rather unifies it, which, as we know, flies directly in the face of unfettered, unregulated free enterprise capitalism. And that makes what we did in the first hour about the socialist basis of the Republican foundation in this country so significant. In other words, the way the nation's history is written, the way our children are educated in what it means and why we are a nation, and what the responsibilities of citizenship are in this nation, the way we do that, how successfully we do it, literally determines the strength of the nation itself. Now we are in a situation where at the top of the nation, we have an administration and a president who is basing re-election on dividing that nation. In other words, on redefining the very nature of our nation. Is it a nation that is inclusive, or will it be a nation that is exclusive? Will we continue to be a nation that welcomes all comers from wherever? Because irrespective of who they are, or where they come from, or what God they worship, or whether in fact they worship a God at all, what color they are, none of that matters in this nation. Or let me put it this way. None of that has mattered in this nation until now. Oh, it mattered in the middle of the 19th century. That's why we had a civil war. And the key issue in all of it was and is again race. Because a president who heads a party committed to the idea of excluding people based on the color of their skin or the God they worship is talking about a nation that is reserved for some, but does not include all. And what the history of this nation is about, and the way it has been written, is about the inclusive nature of this nation and how that factor makes us different than other nations. And all of that is on the table now. All of this is an issue. What we're talking about here is what our nation is and what it will continue to be. Who can be a citizen? And ultimately, who likely, if it goes on, will not be. I think this relates directly to the attack on the cities and the extent to which America's cities are inhabited by a majority of non-white people who traditionally have voted Democratic. What we are talking about is a president who is seeking to build his base and get reelected by appealing to what he calls Middle America. But by Middle America, he doesn't mean the middle class economically. He means the geographic middle of America, which is predominantly white, predominantly conservative, predominantly Republican, and predominantly rural. And what that means is he can't win the majority vote in an election, and he knows that. The only thing that can elect him is the Electoral College, which is why principally progressives within the Democratic Party are beginning to talk about the nation's eventual move to abolish the Electoral College. Originally, it was designed by the founders to be a way that everybody could continue to participate on a somewhat equal basis, no matter what state they lived in, by having a role to play in the election of the president. But now the makeup, the demographics of this nation have changed. And whereas the Electoral College at the beginning seemed to be a strength of holding this nation together, it now serves as a weapon to further divide it. So, back to the question, because we only have about a minute and a half left in our time together today. Why do I believe that this issue raised by Jill Lepore is so important? Because literally it has become, I believe, the most relevant issue on the table for every citizen of this country, whoever they are, whatever color they are, whatever income level they have, whatever God they worship, whether in fact they worship a God at all, whatever gender they are, it doesn't matter. All of us have a stake in what's going on, because what is going on, what is on the table in this election, literally, is the definition of this nation and the direction that this nation's future will go in. That's what this election is about. So when people say, as they do with every election, this may be the most important election that this nation has ever had, I believe that this time around, that's a valid issue. A valid question. I think all of us have a stake in it. And I believe that as we kind of move towards the end of today's program by setting up tomorrow's program. I think tomorrow's program might be one of the, how many times have I said this? Might be one of the most important that we've done in a bit, in a while. But I genuinely believe that to be true. There are things going on right now in this nation that aren't that visible. They're not talked about. The media isn't on them. But the fact of the matter is, they're going to go a long way to determining what the future of this nation looks like. Excuse me. And so I believe that tomorrow's program promises to be one well worth listening to. I totally believe that. My challenge is going to be, can I carry it off? Can I make the whole issue successful? We'll find out tomorrow. We are right at the top of the hour now. So let me again thank you. And let me again thank you for your continued support of the Head On Radio Network, of the efforts of Bob Kincaid and Agnes and the rest, and your support continually for this program. I thank you. Ultimately, you being there is what provides the reward for me to continue to do these programs as long as I can. So thank you. I hope you have a wonderful rest of this Tuesday. I look forward to joining with you again tomorrow. Thank you so much. Have a great day. Thank you.